So let me start off by saying this, that my name is Angela Rinaldo, and I actually work for Workforce Snohomish. And we are the organization here in Snohomish County. We're the WDC, if you will, the Workforce Development District. And my organization is in partnership with Everett and Edmonds Community Colleges to work on the ICAP grant. And the ICAP grant, which is sponsoring, co-sponsoring today this event, is a grant that brings low-income individuals into healthcare professions. So the we've invited today not just our ICAP students, but we made it available to the public at large here at the school. So we'll have some representatives possibly from nursing and other fields as well. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and introduce each of you again. I'm gonna give you about 10 or 15 minutes. Because there's so many of us, I'd ask you to try and keep time for yourself. If you need me to wink or blink or do something, just let me know, okay? And I'll do that. Normally, I try and stay out of it. But anyway, first and foremost, we have Ian Wallace. Ian is the owner and operator of Serenity Woods Adult Family Home. He has a second facility called Four Elements, which will be or is open now, but will be formally licensed by the end of the month. So we start out down here at the end with an adult family home. We'll move on to Amanda Rice. Amanda is a recruiter with the Everett Clinic. Everett Clinic is moved not only now from Snohomish County, now you're in North King County as well, and growing at a huge pace. Your organization recently merged with DaVita, so, but didn't change your name.
Yeah,
that's pretty good, right? I got an A so far. So Amanda represents her organization, which, as I said, involves DaVita as well now. Chad Kaisuya. How'd that go?
Pretty close.
Chad is the general manager of Washington Oaks. And Washington Oaks is a retirement center here in Everett. And I'm going to be putting my name in here pretty quick, because about 10 years from now, I'm going to be living over there.
It's one of
the nicest retirement centers I've seen, and it's right centrally located here in Everett. So great location, beautiful facility, great staff. He's going to tell you about his organization. His first thing he said to me when I met him was he has very little turnover.
That's correct.
What's that mean? He's got happy employees. I want to be there, right? We've got Jodell Leonetti. Jodell works for Community Comprehensive Health Services.
We go by CHCS.
In-home care. So this organization provides privately owned in-home care organization delivering services in the community. And she is the director of operations. So nice to have you. Jesse Berg, Kaiser Permanente, formerly known as Group Health. I was telling Jesse, and this is what he said. I told Jesse, I said, I've been trying for a year and a half to get Group Health here, and as soon as it became Kaiser, I got two people here today. And Jesse's response was, because that's because we're Kaiser, right? Something like that.
Yeah.
So Kaiser apparently has a different public relations formula than perhaps your predecessor, right? Something like that.
That's because they hired me into the position.
There you go. And Jesse is the recruiting operations program coordinator. Lynn Hartman from Community Health Centers of Snohomish County. I had David Griggs as my contact there, and when I said we're doing another employer panel, he was like, I can't be there, but I'll find somebody.
You're stuck with me. Sorry.
Thank you very much. And Glenelle is a HR specialist with Community Health Centers. Danielle Dukart, love that last name for some reason. Providence, recruiter with Providence Health and Services. I have been trying for over a year now to get Providence represented at one of these, so thank you so much. And with her is Jasneet Sandhu, also senior recruiter with Providence. So we've got some really great people here today, and I want to, again, thank you. So I'm going to turn it over to you. I'll stand up when each of you finish, just to acknowledge the next person. Try and keep it 10 to 15 minutes. You all have your questions I sent you? Not you, Ian?
I got them, but we're such a small company, it was so quick to answer them, it might be 4 minutes.
That's all right. Take whatever time you need.
I've got two adult family homes, and if you're not familiar with adult family homes, I'll let you know, it's just a small setting. We cater to assisted living, to hospice. Our motto, like a lot of the industry, is, you know, age in place, so we'd like to, as long as you provide the care services needed for the resident, then they can stay in, as long as it's within our scope of practice. I've owned the business since 2004, and just this year, we've purchased another house, and we're expanding, and it will be a different entity, different name. I think I already mentioned Max is 6 residents. Right now, we currently have 4 employees, so it's a smaller, if you're not looking to be in a large corporate setting, then there's always other options, and that's what the smaller business has. Let's see, what else? Hiring right now, we're kind of at a taking resumes and applications and just having a nice funnel, because I don't know when my staff is going to have something happen in their life, but most often, all of our employees, I think the average has been 4 years or longer. So I think the longest was 9 years. Looking for CNAs, ideally with 2 or more years experience, but if you're a go-getter, we'll review. I think that's it. Again, my name's Ian Wallace, Serenity Woods Adult Family Home. The expansion is going to be called 4 Elements.
So Ian, before we go on to Amanda, tell us a couple of things about what you look for in employees.
Okay.
What are your recruiting sort of hiring process, and some tips on interviewing, so before we move on.
So, let's see. What was the first one that you wanted to
What's your hiring process?
So hiring process, okay. So since we have minimal resources, our hiring process is, you know, Craigslist, friends, associates, family, referrals, that Angela, you have anyone looking, you know. Most often my success has been asking for referrals from existing caregivers that are working for us, because they've usually either worked with that person, they know if they're dependable or whatnot. The process after that would be, I'd like to do a phone interview to start, see if we're able to communicate on the phone good, meet in person, and then obviously if you come on board, we do a 90-day kind of temporary, and then talk about pay increase at the end of 90 days, or, I mean, since we're a small company, we're real flexible. I don't have to get a hold of anybody except for me and the bookkeeper that looks at our mic. Next one.
And what's some tips for interviewing? So when you're talking on the phone with people,
yeah,
what are you looking
for? Tips
for
interviewing, I mean, be yourself. Have a nice agenda as far as what you would want to know if you're looking for employment. Hey, what hours are available? Do you have a set schedule? If not, can I work every single day? I mean, you know, things like that. Like, I want to know, do you have children? Well, if you do, I know I have a 3.5-year-old and a 1-year-old in a few days. So I know that life can sometimes, it's more, you know, family is more important than work. But in this situation, the work actually kind of comes before the family, but we're real flexible too. You need this weekend off? No problem. Let's switch a shift with another staff member. So in the interview process, it would be just kind of like, the goal is, as an employer, and this is basic before we create a relationship, my goal is to get the most amount of work out of the employee for the least amount of pay. Employee's goal is to get the, you know, most amount of pay for the least amount of work, right? So now we just need to meet somewhere in the middle, and now we've got a business relationship. I think tips for, like, dress for success. I mean, if you come in scrubs, I'm fine with that, because that's how you're gonna dress. If you're an attorney, you're probably gonna wear a suit. So, you know, And then we're flexible. I have another company where we do promotional products and company uniforms, so it's great. I can staff you with a uniform too if we want, or everything's flexible.
Thank you.
As long as you're accountable, I'm flexible.
Excellent.
So I work at the Everett Clinic. I work in people services. I'm one of our clinical recruiters, overseeing primarily our medical assisting positions as well as anything in the lab, radiology, and vision center environments. But then we have my kind of counterpart in recruitment oversees a lot of our nursing positions and things like that. So a lot of different opportunities with us. Most of you are probably familiar with the Everett Clinic already. But we have over 15 locations throughout Snohomish County and then into northern King County now as well with our Shoreline location that we opened in September and a Woodinville location that's opening next month. So we're growing right now. We have a lot of opportunities because every time we open a new site, that means we have more people that we need on our team. So that's kind of a little bit about the Everett Clinic. We're a primary care, urgent care, specialty care clinic. We have over 40 different specialties. So if there's any type of specialty department that you have interest in, we probably have it and we are probably staffing for it. As far as just kind of our opportunities of the different types of positions we have that tend to come out of the community college environments, medical assisting, of course, is generally number one for us. We have more MAs at the Everett Clinic than any other type of position. We're going on, I think, close to 400 MAs on the team right now, and I have probably 35 MA openings right now as we're ramping up with some of our next locations. And that being said, the new positions aren't always at the new locations because a lot of times we take existing staff to staff those, so we're not opening a new site with new people at the same time. But then that creates kind of backfill everywhere else. And so we're hiring. We have lots of opportunities for MAs. We also are fully staffed with a nursing team and a phlebotomy team, all kinds of radiology positions at different levels, surgical techs, certified ophthalmic assistants in our vision center environments, and lots of different types of positions like that. And a lot of those positions are good springboards too for growth. A lot of times people kind of either expand on the clinical side of things where maybe they'll start as a phlebotomist or a medical assistant and then move on down the road to nursing school or radiology school or things like that. Then a lot of these folks will move up on the kind of the leadership track as well, moving into using MA as an example, moving from an MA position to an MA lead, and then eventually a supervisory or management position. So lots of opportunities to continue to grow within the world of healthcare, especially when you're kind of one of the benefits of being in a larger organization is you do have those opportunities to grow without necessarily having to go get a job in a different organization. So kind of the two different elements where you can, for some people, being in a small organization with a real family feel is what you're looking for, and sometimes the larger organization. So it kind of just depends on the person. Neither one is right or wrong. We pride ourselves at the Everett Clinic on being a large organization that still has that family feel. Because a lot of our satellites are in smaller communities, then that kind of helps. For each team, you're kind of like your own organization within the larger organization, so you still have your smaller team of the people you're working with on a regular basis and things like that. As far as kind of what our process looks like for folks that are interested in working with us, our application system is all online. So fairly standard there where you can set up a profile and attach your resume and fill out all your information once so that you don't have to do it again every time you're applying for a different position. And then as recruiters, we see each application that comes through. Our system does not do any screening for us, and we like it that way. So it's not that our system is pulling out keywords and picking certain candidates for us and the other applicants we don't see. We actually do look at every application that comes through, check as far as credentialing and things like that, making sure that you're qualified with the education and certifications that you need, and then set up people services interviews from there with either myself or our other recruiter whose name is Amanda also, so that's very confusing. But then from there we check references if we're moving forward with an applicant, and then if everything is continuing to look good there, then we move on to secondary interviews with our hiring managers out in the different departments. We are really passionate about person job fit. We want the right person in the right job. We don't just want someone who can do the job, but someone who's going to really like it and want to be there and be motivated to come to work and be satisfied there, because that type of person and that type of fit is going to provide better care for our patients. So that's something that we're really looking for. kind of along that, kind of across the board, the things that I'm always looking for in every candidate are someone who kind of has the balance between the people skills and the detail-oriented side of things. Because you can go too far on either extreme and it doesn't work, but if you have balance of both of those things, then that's kind of that sweet spot. So we can have kind of the people side of things where somebody really has that heart for healthcare, heart for patient care, and that compassion and empathy and really wanting to be in a people-oriented environment and helping care for our patients and our community. But then also balancing that out with the side of things where healthcare is a very safety-oriented industry. It's an industry where details are very important. So someone who's going to be able to be really accountable to being thorough and dependable and following through on what you need to do and making sure things get done correctly so that we're providing safe care for our patients and not just like hearts and stars and rainbow, happy, we love you care. So kind of balancing both of those pieces is really important. And then also something that's big for us, especially with the growth that we're experiencing right now, is someone who's really coming in with an innovative mindset and coming in with ideas of how can we do things better, how can we do things more efficiently, how can we improve the quality of care, those types of things. Because that's what we're trying to do as an organization, is provide better and better care. And so then if we as an organization are heading in that direction, we have to have team members who are also like-minded in that. And so that's something that's really important, something that we're trying to find out, kind of who fits that mold. Teamwork probably then for me is the final thing that's really important as far as what I'm looking for, because in healthcare, nobody is an island. Everybody has kind of their own separate scope based on your position. And then even people within the same position have their own kind of niche of what they're working on based on what provider they're working with or what patient population they're working with. And all of that has to come together in order to have coordinated care, because there's that complexity of healthcare that makes teamwork important. And so everybody has to really work together, from our reception team to our clinical staff to our providers, to administrative departments. Everybody has to be able to coordinate that care and work together in order to provide the best care for patients. So those are some of the things that I'm looking for. As far as interview tips, one of the big things that I always kind of want folks to be prepared for is that we do behavioral-based interviewing as far as our questioning style. And so most of our questions are kind of phrased as, tell me about a time when you did this or you experienced this and how you responded to it. Because kind of the buzzword in any HR environment is that past behavior is the best predictor of future performance. We don't necessarily want to know what you think you'll do, because everybody kind of has they know what the right answer is of what they're supposed to do in a difficult circumstance. But we want to know what you've actually done in the past to prove that that's what you'll do in the future. And so we ask a lot of questions like that. Tell me about a time when you faced a difficult situation at work and how you handled that. Tell me about a time when you had an idea of how to improve a process in your work environment and what you did there. Tell me about a time when you received coaching on something that you needed to work on and how you responded to that. So different types of questions like that. So my suggestion is always kind of have your toolbox of some different stories, of some different experiences that you've had, either at work or school or in your clinicals if you're at that point, and be prepared with some of those examples that you can use to answer those types of questions. Examples of circumstances where you feel like you did something really well and had a success at work that says something good about you, because that's going to speak more loudly than just naming characteristics that you would like to have, things like that. As far as attire for an interview, we touched on this a little bit already. I'm with you that interviewing in scrubs is fine. Business professional is great. Don't wear jeans to an interview. But if you don't feel like you have something business professional that is interview ready, scrubs are completely fine as well. We're a healthcare organization. That's what you're going to be wearing when you're at work anyway. So something like that is fine.
Sounds good.
I'm the general manager of Washington Oaks Retirement Community here in Everett. At Washington Oaks, we have about 70 employees. I have one RN, one LPN, staff of 12 caregivers. So on the medical side, we're not huge. The rest of my staff, dining room servers, cooks, housekeepers, activities people, front desk receptionists. We look after about 165 senior citizens. We have about 152 apartments, so we're about a medium-sized retirement community. We're not big, We're not small, we're somewhere in the middle. About 70% of my residents are fully independent, and about 30% receive some level of assisted living services, and that's where the nurse, the LPN, and the caregivers come in. Our parent company is called Leisure Care. Leisure Care manages about 35 communities like mine across the country, and now we're growing internationally. We're in the process of building two communities in London, England, and one in Mexico. So we are expanding internationally, which is kind of cool. Our company has some very, we have a kind of a different, in my opinion, forward-thinking corporate culture. Some of our slogans, some of the things that we're pushed to do will kind of explain that. For example, our company slogan is five-star fun. I was in hotel management for 21 years, never heard anything close to that. What our president says is, my responsibility as a general manager is to make sure that my residents have the opportunity to have fun every single day. Whether they take advantage of it or not is up to them, but I have to make sure they have that opportunity. He said, whether you're 2 years old or 95 years old, you want to have fun. You want to laugh, you want to smile, you want to do something you enjoy. So that's our company slogan, believe it or not. Our company directive is what our corporate office tells everybody should be your goal, is to improve the lives of seniors every single day. And again, in the hotel business, never heard anything even close to that. We also try and expand that to improving the lives of everybody you come into contact with every single day. So what our president said was, you know, when you're standing in an elevator, don't look at the door. Turn around and face the other people in the elevator and just say hi. When you're standing in line at the supermarket, everybody's late, everybody's pissed off, just talk to the people around you, put a smile on their face. That's, again, our corporate culture, what we're asked to do. A smile and a hello can go a long way. Our corporate philosophy is to do the right thing. That means every day, every time. If you have that in mind, it makes every decision you make every day a lot simpler. Just remember, the goal is to do the right thing for all the parties involved. Again, I think my hotel school professors are turning over in their graves when I'm talking about this stuff. That's not what we're taught. At a general manager's conference earlier in my career, we have one every year, our president said the following two things that really resonated with me. First of all, he said, you need to take good care of your employees and let them take good care of your residents. The other thing he said that I've held close to my heart for the last 12 years, he said, the customer is not always right. And that's all I ever heard in the hotel business. The customer is always right. My boss in this company says that is not true. And for any of you who have worked in this industry or close to this industry working with residents or patients and their families, you probably know they are not always right. And my boss gave us permission to accept that. As a general manager, we're coached to live something called a three-thirds lifestyle. Again, nothing I've ever heard of before. We're supposed to, I can't say that I do, but we're supposed to dedicate one-third of our time and energy to our family, one-third of our time and energy to our community, so nonprofits, charities, church, children's organizations, anything that's near and dear to your heart that'll help your greater community. And according to my boss, we're supposed to give the last third of our time and energy to our job. Please don't tell him I said this, that's really not practical. But I think it's a great philosophy. You know, there's so many of my counterparts that do get involved in charity organizations and nonprofits, and they spend a lot of time in. Our corporate office is one of the major funding partners for Treehouse, Children's Charity in downtown Seattle. They actually go out and deliver hot meals for Union Gospel Mission, and that's corporate office guys. It's pretty cool, and they try and live what they preach for us to do. Year after year, as Angela mentioned, Washington Oaks has one of the lowest employee turnover percentages in our company, and I believe in our industry as a whole. At Washington Oaks, our annual employee turnover is about less than 30%, which might not sound that great. But I would tell you, industry-wide, most communities of my size or close to it, probably 50 to 150% per year. And the 30% turnover that we have, there's kind of a reason for that. My biggest department is my dining room servers, our food servers, our wait staff. 27 people. Almost all of them we hire when they're in high school. So what happens in 2 years? They graduate. They go out and get real jobs, or they move out of mom and dad's house, so they leave us. And that's fine, but that's most of the 30% that we lose every year. Everybody else pretty much stays. I think one of the reasons is because we hire and retain employees with the correct spirit and heart, not necessarily those with the best experience listed on their resume. We look for people who have the desire and willingness to care for others, and we treat them fairly. You can earn more money working somewhere else. Of that, I am certain. But I don't know that you'll find a better overall working experience than you might find with us. I was asked to talk a little bit about benefits. We offer a full medical, dental, and vision, but that doesn't mean it doesn't cost you anything. The way it works is if, and I didn't make these rules and I'm sorry, if you're female, you're probably going to pay about $200 a month for medical, dental, and vision, and we will pay about $500 a month for the rest of it. If you're male, you'll probably pay about $150 a month. And ladies, I'm sorry, I didn't make that rule, and then we pay for the rest. But that's how the insurance companies have it set up. You get paid vacation. You start accruing vacation, if I'm not mistaken, from day one, and you can take it after your first year. You get a week's paid vacation after your first year, and I think 2 weeks after your third year, if I'm not mistaken. You also get 5 paid holidays. I believe it's after 6 months being full-time, so 5 paid holidays per year. So those are kind of the benefits we offer. If you're talking about some tips, again, What I would suggest to you is dress the best you can. Dress for success, but again, what I would tell you is if you come in not wearing the best clothes, it's okay. It's not necessarily going to be a negative. But for guys, we had I think in my 12 years, 2 guys come in looking for a dining room server position wearing a shirt and a necktie. It gave them a leg up. My dining room supervisor came in, hey boss, this guy came in wearing a tie, he was sharp, he was articulate. It says something about who you are and who you want to be. So I'm not saying that you have to go out and buy a $500 suit, but dress the best you can. Very important to me, and like I said, I'm different than a lot of people, for God's sakes, don't be late. I don't care about your excuses. When I first got to Washington Oaks, we have a weekly department head meeting. Starts at 9:30. For about my first 3 months, it would start at 9:35, 9:40. I'd have staff coming in carrying Starbucks 5 minutes late. Finally, I stood up and said, look, I want you guys to think about it this way. If I told you that I was going to give you $100,000 on January 1st, if you showed up at this meeting every week without being a second late, would I hear about your car battery? Would I hear about your kid's sniffles? Would I hear about your dog being sick? Or would your butt be in this meeting room every week at 9:30? So it's just a matter of priorities. And I'm hoping that if you're looking for a job, it's a priority. When somebody comes in late for an interview, they've already got strike 2, at least when they're interviewing with me. So get there early, wait out in your car, do whatever. Don't show up late. Turn off your phone, please. When I'm interviewing somebody and they're checking their emails and answering their calls, don't do it, please. The way it works, come into Washington Oaks. We're 7 blocks south. We're not hard to get to. Come into the front desk. We're open 24 hours a day. Get an application. Fill it out. Whatever is the appropriate department head will call you in for an interview. If you do well with them, they'll ask you to come in for a second interview with me. And I will tell you, in 12 years, anybody that's gone through a first interview with my department heads and passed them, I've never said no. So your second interview is a piece of cake.
So who wants to work with the best home health and home care company in the Pacific Northwest? Anyone here? All right, well, we consider, you do, great.
I do too.
Good. So we consider ourselves one of the best for many reasons, but the main reason is because of who we hire. Who we hire is the face of the company. You're the ones going out there and doing the really hard job. So our company goal is to, we have individuals that are able to remain in their homes or their communities with our help. And so we provide skilled nursing care RNs and LPNs and occupational therapists and physical therapists and certified nursing assistants. And our office is located in Edmonds, but we help clients all over the Seattle area. I'd like to say within a 2-hour radius in every direction of Edmonds. What sets our company apart is it's one-on-one care. It's great for some people, not great for others. Some CNAs love it because you get a bond with your client. You get to really focus on your client and help improve their life. We're a locally owned company. We're also doctor owned, which I think is the best. I came from California where I owned my own home care company, and I'm not even a CNA. And so what attracted me to move to Seattle and work for this company is it's doctor owned. And so they work in hospitals. I don't see them every day, but they are very much part of the company. I call them all throughout the day if I have any questions. So it's a nice piece. One works at Providence Hospital and one works at Northwest Hospital. We're also Joint Commission accredited, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. Besides being a home care company, we're also a licensed home health. And so what's nice about that is if a doctor puts in an order to us, they need an RN, they need a PT, and they need a CNA, it's all under one roof, which is really nice because we all talk amongst ourselves and can provide the best possible care to our clients. We also have care management services. I don't know if you talk about much about that, but it's basically an RN that, basically it's all private pay, that has the RN come to their home and either sets meds for them, schedules doctor's appointments, goes to their appointments, and so they advocate for the client. And so it's a nice piece with the CNA. We also are really big with pushing continued education. We want our employees to be nurse delegated, and that's where under an RN license you can provide certain extra things for a client, like a bowel program, feeding tube, suctioning. So it's a nice piece that you get to learn a little extra, I believe, with us. We also have a lot of quadriplegic clients, and so we have a spinal cord injury class we have you take, and then you're certified for that through our company. We have a real wide range of clients, and so it's a nice piece. My background before was in elder care, and now we have clients as young as 5, all the way up to people in their hundreds. So the nice piece for the CNA is they really get to use all of their skills. And a lot of our cases are more medically complex. One of our lead caregivers, she loves it. She works 5 days a week for us. One day a week she works with a senior that has dementia. 2 days a week she works with this cute little girl, and it's a pediatric client, and she has a weird disorder. And then one day a week she gets to work with a spinal cord injury client. So she really gets to use her CNA skills. I like my notes. Anyone like gift cards? Anyone like gift cards? So you paid a lot of attention. I watched you. This is a gift card for you.
All right.
And you too. So maybe the two people up front, right? So this is a big part of our company culture. Every morning we meet as a management team, and we call it compliment time. And so we all discuss any compliments we can give to our employees, that families give, or just the office gives, the nurses give. And we try to get 20 per week. It's our big goal. And then we send out these gift cards to our employees and thank them, write a little special note. And then at the end of the month, we look at who had the most compliments, and they become we call it the rising star. So it's an employee of the month. And they get a big bonus in their check, $100, I think it's big. And then at the end of the year, we vote on the 12 that were throughout the year, and they get a $500 bonus. And so it kind of just tells you our company culture. We really want to recognize our employees. For our shifts, we have all different types of shifts, which really work for people that go to school. We have day shifts, night shifts, and we try to work around your schedule. My favorite is the travel shifts. So if a client wants to go to Italy, you get to go to Italy, all expense paid. It hasn't happened yet, but I'll probably become a CNA if it does. We make a lot of promises to our clients. We promise that our employees will be consistent, reliable, dependable, and on time. So the interview process, I'll talk a little about that. When we invite you to come in for an interview, I definitely pay attention if you showed up on time. If you show up late, I'm such a nice person, but if you show up late, you see like a different side of me, because I actually send you home. And the reason being is because if you're going to show up late to interview with me, you're going to show up late to my client's house. And I tell them that. And they're like, no, no, I promise. I'm like, you showed up late here. I know you're going to show up late. So I send you home. Also, the phone, that's the one that does drive me crazy. If you have your phone on, it rings. If you answer your phone during the interview, that really makes me not so happy. So you probably won't pass the interview process. After, we also do a CNA skill test. It's a 50-question skill test. As long as you have the skills, you'll pass it. Some people come in there and it's like scary to see the 50 questions. Most people can pass it. And part of the interview process, when you interview with me, I'm asking questions that I'm trying to find out your commitment to safety. Are you trustworthy? Are you, you know, accountability? Are you result oriented? You know, what's your expertise? Are you respectful? I had to do a verbal warning with an employee this morning, and he, at the end, he said to me, "You're making such a big deal of this." And I was like, "Whoa, yeah, that's not a respectful person. I should have caught that in the interview." So we're really looking for that. Are you going to help your client's dignity remain intact? What's your passion? Is it just about a paycheck, or is this your life calling? And in my questions, I do get that out of you. And then in the interview with, we don't wear scrubs in home care or jeans. We dress like, most clients want you to look like their family member, their friend. They don't want you to look like they're sick and they hired you to come take care of them. So I do prefer people to wear nice pants and nice tops to an interview. Scrubs, I worry, do you have nice pants? And if you wear jeans, I know you're going to wear jeans to work if you show up to the interview in jeans. And so, obviously, part of our we do background checks, fingerprints, we check your references. So there's the whole process before we bring you on. The other thing, once we bring you on, we have an 8-hour orientation where we go over policies and procedures. And we have a nurse involved, they do a skills verification. And it's a pretty neat process. Everyone who comes from it says that they learned a lot from it. So it's additional education. And people don't realize it's also part of your interview process. I would say if I have a room of 10 people, one of them, after that orientation of 8 hours with me, is not going to make it to the end where we're going to offer you work. Because a lot comes out in that. And so people don't realize we're actually interviewing you in this 8-hour orientation. All right, I got off track. No. Anyone, I'll keep going. I have one more last part. I'll talk about some benefits. So we offer a 401k, and our pay range is a real wide spectrum. Anywhere from $13.75 an hour to $18 an hour, and it just depends. We work in some facilities, so if a facility has a CNA that calls in sick, or doesn't show up to work, or we can fill those shifts for them within like 10 minutes time, a lot of times. No, hopefully an hour's notice. So if you work in a facility through us, we're gonna be able to pay you about $18 an hour. But normal one-on-one care is around $14 to $15 an hour. And like I mentioned before, we're big into tuition, so we do have tuition reimbursement. And there's a lot of room to grow in the company. I have several positions where I offered someone a job today that was a superstar CNA for the last 6 months, and I promoted her to come work for me, under me in operations. And so I have three people like that are CNAs, and that they do emergency shifts for me, and then they help me in the office. So it's a pretty good promotion for them.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jesse Berg. I'm the Recruiting Operations Program Coordinator from Kaiser Permanente of Washington. I'm here with my colleague Heidi Schell, who is a manager of our laboratory down at our Capitol Hill campus. So to start out, basically what we're looking for in our Snohomish County clinics, which would be Everett and Linwood. So right off the bat, we are totally looking for ARNPs, LPNs, RNs, MAs, especially MAs, pharmacy assistants. We also have patient access rep openings, which are basically like our entry-level front desk positions. That's kind of how I actually got in the door, was actually at Everett as a patient access rep, and kind of worked my way up from there. So it's an excellent way to get in. So also, kind of an overview of who we are. So as was said, we used to be Group Health formerly. So after we got bought out by Kaiser Permanente, we basically just took the whole group health region, and that's now Kaiser Permanente of Washington. So really nothing has changed. Like, most of the structure of the company is exactly the same as it was. It's completely self-governing. So Kaiser is basically, it's based out of Oakland, California, but all of the regions are completely separate and self-governing. So that's kind of what we are, but like centrally we report to California. So right now in our region of Washington, we have 6,800 employees. If you include our physician group, we're around 8,000. So Kaiser Washington is a HMO. So what that means, it's like an integrated care company. So we give care, pretty much anything you need. But also we are health insurance as well. So it kind of saves you money when everything is kind of in-house. And so we kind of use that to keep costs down. And also Kaiser, just like Group Health, is a not-for-profit company. And in our region, we have 26 primary care clinics, and we stretch as far north as Bellingham, and as far south as Olympia, and we also are on the Kitsap Peninsula, and looking to expand. And we are also in the Spokane region as well. Let's see. So our organizational culture, Group Health is really focused on diversity, and Kaiser is even more so. I think, like, I don't know the actual stat, but I know that in medical companies, I think they're number one in diversity in the country. It's like one of their biggest strong suits. Kaiser Permanente of Washington is 80% women, which I didn't know until yesterday, but it's pretty apparent. Kaiser Permanente Washington is very focused on internal promotions. Our executive in human resources really was pushing for that. I was actually her executive assistant for about a year and a half, and she was so adamant that we had to stop like focusing on hiring outside people for management positions and start kind of bringing people up from the bottom and making sure that people are coming in entry level and they can work their way up the ladder easily, and try to guide people into management and in hopefully even executive positions eventually. By 2019, the goal is that 90% of our managers will be internal promotions. So if you're looking to really move up, it's still a good idea to get in at the ground floor. I mean, there's plenty of opportunity there. Right now, I think we're at 9% market share in the region for health insurance, and the goal is to hit 20% by 2025. And we really want to go for 1 million members by 2025 in the state. They're really looking to grow. Group Health was making money at the end, but Kaiser is like, they're just flush. Like, so them kind of stepping in here, we're really able to invest right now, and they want to grow and they want to pursue new members. So if you're looking for big growth opportunities and fast change, come on in. So they're really big on, just like Group Health was, they're really big on like holistic care. Healthy lifestyles are super important. Really focused on preventive medicine, which helps affordability. I mean, if you get in early and make sure that people are staying healthy and getting exercise, focusing on diet. Like, my doctor's always railing on me to get on like a Mediterranean diet all the time, and like, I'm 34 and single, ate pizza, so I'm sorry. Like, I'll get a Mediterranean style pizza. but like, in the end, like, yeah, preventive medicine, it's better for everybody. It means that people pay less in their health insurance premium. It's just better for everyone for access. They're massively upgrading our IT infrastructure. Like, it was okay before, but now, like, the plans that they have are insane. And we have a new campus that we're actually moving into, like, tomorrow in Renton from Tukwila, from our main campus. And their IT is just like, it looks like the command room from Jurassic Park, you know, like with the giant like monitors, and it's like this huge command center. It's super impressive. So they want to start doing that with our facilities too. They want to like make them look nice, start building really nice facilities. kind of finding like our facilities that need like the most upgrades right now. And there are a few, and they really have some big plans for that. Benefits. Of course, you have your health insurance benefits, and they're super cheap to contribute to through your paychecks. I think it's like for a single person, I want to say $30 every two weeks, and a $100 deductible. Dental is actually really good. It's gotten a lot better. We have a few different dental plans you can choose from. Vision is really good. You get a sick leave, vacation time. Our PTO accrual is actually really fast. And the longer you stay in the company, the faster your PTO accrues. I think I am at 11 and a half years now, and I get almost a month off a year. So you can do your travels and everything like that. You also get a flex spending account, so you can contribute money tax-free to a health spending account that you can use on even like elective medical stuff of some sorts, dental stuff. I got 3 crowns last year with my flex spending. Let's see, you get a floating holiday, so once a year you get one day that you can use on whatever you want. I just throw it into my vacation, but some people use it for their birthdays or whatever they want to do. We have a 403b plan, which is similar to a 401k, but for a not-for-profit company, it's a 403b. It's basically the same thing, and the company matches 50% of your contributions up to the first 4%. So they're really generous on that. You also get to jump into a defined contribution plan where the company just puts in a lump sum of money every paycheck that just accrues, and then it matures as when you retire, and it just starts paying out. And there is a program called Virtual High Five, where if one of your colleagues like does something very excellent, like not even just for you, for anybody, and you notice it, a way to call it out is to give them a virtual high five. You just go through this website, and you can pick a point level, and they get a certain amount of points that they can use on gift cards, travel, clothing, even like really nice stuff. Like you can get, if you did really good on a project that took a month, you could probably get like a $20 like J. Crew gift card out of that, or like free movie tickets. You get employee discounts, which they're not utilized as much, but they're there. Like you get discounts for like cell phone plans, gyms. Started looking at our career site at the end of the year. We start hiring for interns into the following year. And let's see, a couple of things I want to shout out. We do have a open house in Bellevue next Tuesday from 3 to 6 p.m. You can find it on our career site if you want more information. We also have one at Capitol Hill next Thursday from 3 to 7. That's also on our career site. And lastly, our hiring process and what to look for in an applicant and interview tips, I'm going to give that over to Heidi because she's involved in the interview process.
Absolutely. When you show up to the interview, I'm with Tad. Put your best foot forward. Show up and show me that you want this job. Don't come in with a see-through shirt. Show me that you want this job. Dress professionally. Show up on time. Don't have a coffee cup in your hand, don't have your phone on. Be prepared. Again, like Amanda, we do behavioral-based interviewing, and if you go online, you can look at what kind of questions are involved in behavioral-based interviewing. If you're not prepared for that, you're going to walk in, you're gonna look like, deer in the headlights. You're not gonna know how to answer those questions, because we're gonna ask you tell me about a time when you demonstrated this or demonstrated that. And what I'm trying to do is find out, are you capable of being a part of a team? Are you capable of working together and paying attention to detail? And really, being a member that's valuable to our team. The skills you just learned are great, but 70% of it is who you are and are you capable of being there? I can teach you more skills. I can make sure you get more skills. But I can't change who you are. And I can't change that you don't know how to be a team member. Or so put that forward. Let me know that you're a team member. Let me know that you know what it means to give customer service. One of my favorite questions is tell me what it means to give good customer service. And, you know, it could be, I received good customer service and here's what happened, or here's how I gave it. But do you know what that even means? If you don't, if you tell me that I did my job that day, that you didn't go above and beyond, you didn't do anything other than what was exactly required of you to serve that customer. And so are you capable of really, you know, giving that to your customers? Because that's what we do. We want to make sure that every patient that walks into our facility walks out with a smile, walks out knowing that they've been cared for and that somebody heard them. So, you know, we work really hard at making sure that that's the process that works for us.
All right, so good afternoon. I'm Linnell Hartman. I'm with the Community Health Center of Snohomish County, also known as CHC, not to be confused with CHCS. We are a nonprofit healthcare provider. We provide medical, dental, and pharmacy services to those who are in need. Many of you may be familiar with some of the locations here in Everett. We have one right here on Broadway. We have another one in South Everett on 112th. We have one in Linwood, which is actually an urgent care walk-in for both medical and dental. We also have a clinic in Edmonds, and then we go as far north as Arlington right now. So those are our five main clinics. We also have the administration building in Everett on Casino and Evergreen Way, which is where I work. By the end of this year, beginning of next year actually, we'll be opening up our sixth clinic, which will be medical walk-in as well as family practice. And that will be on Evergreen and 41st. So of course we're going to have a lot of positions open. We are always looking for medical assistants. Because we provide dental, we also look for dental assistants, providers, you name it, we're looking for it. So we talk about our locations, our sizes, the services. So I mentioned we offer medical, dental, pharmacy. What many people don't know about us is we also provide behavioral health and psychiatric care as well. It's a great need in our county, and that we provide that. We actually have an ARNP who goes out to our homeless population every single day and works with them, especially at night, to find them the basic medical care that they need. We work with our school districts to get our students sealants. We have a sealant program as well. We also have our HIV and hepatitis clinic, which is based out of our Everett North clinic. And we partner with our UW medical services to actually help support that clinic. We have internal medicine, you name it, we really do have it. And again, we're nonprofit, so we actually support those who don't have insurance, who may have insurance, but it doesn't cover all the services that they need. Most of our population, actually 9% of the individuals that we support, are below the federal poverty line. So for a family of four, that's less than $24,000 a year. 89% of our patients are in Medicaid. And 7% are actually uninsured. And the surprising fact for me was that 40% of our patients are actually under the age of 20, and many of those are actually homeless. And then 1/3 of our patients, they actually speak a language other than English. In fact, we have patients who literally walk in the clinic and have never had medical care, and they do not speak a single word of English. So we actually provide a bilingual skill pay, so if you speak a second language, we'll pay you on top of your base pay for that, as well as use language line services to help translate for those patients. So you guys know, our goals and our mission. So we're extremely mission-based. Our mission is to provide a diverse community with access to high-quality, affordable primary health care, and that it's very important to us that a healthy community is achieved through access to that health care. We do provide benefits, so our medical, dental, and vision is provided free to our employees. If you'd like to add your dependents, you can certainly do that. If there is a cost to you, you pay the difference between the employee portion and what the company needs to pay for that. We also have, of course, paid time off, extended illness banks, short-term disability. We have a 403B, which is similar to a 401K, but it's 403B because it's a nonprofit. And after your first year of service, the company will actually match dollar for dollar up to the first 5% that you contribute to your 403B. We have paid holidays, and for our medical assistants and dental assistants right now, we do offer a sign-on bonus as well. And tuition assistance, that's important. We actually have quite a few medical assistants who will come into our organization and they realize that actually they want to become an RN and go that step further. So we will actually help support them, not only keep them employed and pay for part of their schooling, but help them actually career path and get into the next role that they like to get into. We do offer externships too. They're unpaid, but we do partner with different schools in Snohomish County to have externships at our locations. See, our hiring process, so that is done all online. You apply for the position, include your resume. It's always really good to include your certifications so we know that you are certified or that you're in the process of obtaining that. And then our managers actually go through every single application to review it for, if you're obviously qualified for the position. And then they will call you and do a phone screen first. If that goes well, then they'll actually bring you into the clinic and we'll do what's called a cultural interview. Because we are very mission-based, it's very important to us that our employee population is mission-driven. If you are not mission-driven, CHC is probably not going to be the place for you, because that's our sole, the core of our organization. And then if you get called in by the manager to do a cultural interview, then you can proceed with them to do the formal interview as well, which we'll do at the same time. At that point, hopefully you get called back and get offered the position. Of course, it's all about the mission. So as long as you're mission-based, would be a great fit for CHC. Like I said, if you're looking for just a JOB, it's not going to be the best place for you to be. Let's see, interview tips. I think the biggest tip I have for you is research the organization that you're applying for, whether it's CHC or some other organization. You want to know what their core values are, what their population or their patient or customer population is. What challenges you may have in joining that organization, and then also what benefits you'll bring. If you have a second language that you speak or a third language, bring that to the interview. Let us know that you can do that. Let's see. I think that covers everything that we have. If you if you know anybody who wants to get into healthcare and they're going through school now, we also have health information specialist positions. We also have housekeeping, which is great for those who are going to school because it's either after hours or throughout the day that fits really well into a school schedule. And then you can continue in the CHC once you get your certifications as well.
I am part of our nursing team, so I recruit for support roles, CNAs, some RNs as well. So I'll speak to that and then let Jasmine speak to her other service areas. Providence is also a nonprofit Catholic organization. We're currently the third largest nonprofit healthcare system in the country. With that, we're also very mission-driven. Our mission is, as people of Providence, we reveal God's love for all, especially the poor and vulnerable, through our compassionate service. So when we're looking for, candidates, regardless of the position, that's kind of the primary focus is, are you mission-driven? Are you compassionate? Also very safety-driven. I did have a question. Is anybody here currently in the CNA program here at the Community College?
I'm already a CNA.
Okay. Yep. So they have a great program here. One of the current initiatives of Providence is to kind of cater to the nursing shortage that everyone is going to have. So they have a nursing, nursing academy. Which is kind of devoted to the curriculum for our, residents and fellows. They cater really, they cater a lot to CNAs who are in school to become an RN. So they're very flexible, with your schedule. So another, great thing to keep in mind. I would say for, the hiring process, pretty general, regardless if you apply through Indeed or any of those other sources, it's all fed into our applicant tracking system. I have to agree, please make sure that your resume is, up to date, include all of your experience, make sure there's no typos. Our system doesn't require you to attach a resume, but I would highly recommend that you do that. It does require you to put in one job as part of your history, and if you just have like your recent job that you started a month ago, that looks like you're a brand new, whatever your position is. So I highly recommend that you attach that as well. For interviewing, same thing, come dressed professionally. We have had people show up in see-through shirts and it doesn't end very well, so definitely don't do that. If you want to show up in scrubs, that's fine as well. Be ready to talk about your experiences. We also do behavioral and situational questions. So a lot of stuff around, you know, challenging patients or situations. Also safety, again, with the mission, you know, how have you showed compassion, things like that. With our benefits, they do vary slightly from region to region, but we do offer benefits on day one, so there's no waiting period, which is absolutely phenomenal. They do include medical, dental, vision, life and disability insurance, a retirement plan. We also have a 403B. And then paid vacation, which starts accruing on your first pay period as well.
So I'll talk a little bit more about the areas that I cover. Hi everyone, my name is Jess Neath, and I'm on the same team as Danielle. However, we support different areas, and I support all of our specialty clinics in Western Washington, which are all the way north from Monroe to Snohomish, all the way to the peninsula in Aberdeen, and then through Lacey and Centralia. So we're all over Western Washington. But in general, Providence, we're in five states, and so we are, you know, a very large organization. And in all of our states, we offer services ranging from hospital acute care to home health, hospice, to the clinic. So there's a lot of opportunities regardless of, you know, whatever you're looking for. So in the clinics right now, we are recruiting for and looking for, you know, MAs, RNs. We're looking for patient service representatives, HISs or health information specialists. We also recruit for social workers and clinical psychologists in the clinics as well that offer mental health services in those primary and specialty care clinics. You know, we also in the clinics offer roles for, you know, support, you know, front office and clinical supervision roles, management positions. And then in our different ministries, so in home health, you know, we offer different roles there. So occupational therapy, physical therapy, CNAs, LPNs, RNs. And then in the hospital area, in addition to Danielle's area, you know, we also recruit for environmental services, food service, you know, nursing. So it's a wide gamut, so it really depends on what you're looking for, what your interest is, and what type of specialty area you're looking to get exposure in, because we call them different flavors, but every part of the organization kind of has a different tangent, and so it really depends on what kind of services you're looking to provide and how you feel like you can make an impact. So that's why it's kind of hard to talk about one specific role, because there's just so much that is available at Providence right now. So specifically in the clinics right now, we are, as I said, looking for MAs and RNs. In terms of the application process, it mirrors the acute care side of things, but basically, you know, go to our website, providenceiscalling.jobs, and look at what's out there, do a keyword search. You know, sometimes the same job can be a little bit different in different ministries. So a CNA position in home health is different than on the hospital side of things. So, you know, research them, look at what interests you, and what kind of areas and departments you're wanting to get, you know, exposure to. So just kind of do your research on that and really be informed about the kinds of jobs you're applying to. You know, be just I guess what I'd like to say is just know what you're going to be happy doing going forward. So don't apply to 50 jobs knowing that, you know, you don't want to work weekends. So, you know, don't apply to hospital positions where it requires you to work weekends. So look at the postings and be informed about the kinds of opportunities that you're seeking. And know what you're interested in. Do you want to work with a geriatric population? Do you want to work with peds patients? So, you know, just be informed as applicants, because if you pursue and show an interest in something, you know, that'll allow you to have an upper hand or an edge to those managers where you're showing your passion for a certain patient population. So. But yes, do, you know, upload your resume. It's always great to overshare information than undershare. So if it is one of your first, you know, full-time work opportunities in healthcare, maybe you've only been a nurse or an MA for 6 months to a year, please do provide any other information about any other customer service jobs you've held in the past. No experiences, you know, any other experience is also important. So you want to know what you've done in the background, aside from your healthcare position. But interview tips, again, we also utilize behavioral interviewing and situational-based interviewing. What I would say is, kind of regardless of the company you're applying to and the organization specifically, what managers and what we in recruiting really want to look for is how do you approach customer service in a healthcare organization. Each organization kind of has a different flavor of how they approach that, but you know, I know at Providence we really do provide compassionate care, which is how do you provide, you know, empathy and customer service to not only patients but their families in, you know, hard, you know, in really difficult situations. So tell us about, you know, how you would walk a patient through that process. You know, what have you done in a customer service job before, if not healthcare, that can maybe be a parallel to the kind of work that you may be going or maybe doing in a, you know, in a healthcare position. So we really want to drill down to what gets you motivated, how you've operated in the past, and those behaviors that would lead us to believe that you would operate in a similar fashion in a new job. So use Google as your friend to help yourself with research on organizations and what you can do to, you know, polish your skills if you feel like you need to get some practice. So there's a lot of resources out there. I don't think applicants really utilize the internet enough to help them. So please do your research and just utilize that to help you research those positions and the interview and, you know, how to do well in an interview process. So the first round, we would, you know, once you apply, we do the initial screening, all the recruiters do, then we invite you to do a phone interview with one of us, and they can last anywhere from 30 minutes to an hour, kind of depending on the type of position it is. If you meet the criteria for the position, we then forward you over to the hiring team for further review and typically get you set up with an in-person interview with the clinical teams, whether they're in the hospital or whether they're in the clinic, it just, you know, varies. That process can be anywhere from 1 to 2 interviews as well, but you would have an opportunity to meet with the manager, possibly providers, other team members that you would be working with in that clinical environment. And then we would follow up with applicants as that process goes through. But in regards to tips, yeah, please dress for success. I'd like to just mirror what everyone else has said. You know, just be polished. You know, you don't have to have the most expensive clothes, but just have confidence in yourself. Just carry yourself in a professional way. Just, you know, show up for the job you want to have. So just be ready to go. Don't be late. Please turn your cell phone off. We have heard horror stories of people that have actually had conversations on their cell phone while they've been in an interview. So it kind of is mind-boggling, but just be ready to showcase your skills and experience and let your experience speak for itself. Just have confidence in yourself.
Great. Okay, question time. So, CNA, starting salary, Ian.
13 during the first 90 days, unless you've got incredible experience, and it could be 15 to start.
You don't use CNAs? 10.
12.
12, so 13.75? 13.75. You don't use them, CNAs?
It depends on our region. In Southwest Washington, so for our Centralia and Olympia, they're right around 14.46. Up here in Everett, it's 15.60.
15.60. What's the difference? What's the variance? Tell me.
Market?
Yeah. Okay.
Cost of living, those sort of things. Also, some of our ministries are union, some are non-union, so that does play a factor as well.
Because you're all requiring the same education, so why do we have such a differential?
Because we didn't call each other first.
How about MA? Starting salary MA?
1844.
I think it's around there. I'm not sure.
You know, yeah. Starting salary, I mean.
I can tell you for phlebotomist, it's 1760.
Okay.
17.
17. MAs,
it's,
you know.
It's between 17 and 18.
Because you have some clinics too, don't
yes,
you?
Yes,
yeah,
yes.
So 17, 18. So we've got private companies. So Ian owns a private company. Jodell, you work for a privately owned company. Then we have some corporations. So Tad, you work for a privately owned corporation. Then we have some nonprofit corporations. Can somebody tell us what the difference is? What do you think is the, I mean, I can give an academic answer here, but what do you think the differences are?
Focus.
Go ahead.
Focus.
Okay.
On the dollar or the patient.
So part of it is focus.
It can be both, sorry.
That's so it can be both. And it's, I appreciate the honesty because that's what I want to talk about is the honesty. So what did you hear, and by the way, just a personal thank you, because as a professional in the community who has worked with low-income homeless people for years, without your organization here, Community Health Centers, we would be screwed. I'm not kidding you. We would be screwed because you are the only provider who will see somebody with no insurance. Without your organization, I would have dead patients. I have brought so many individuals to your hospital who have overdosed and have provided services, psychiatric services. Unbelievable work. So thank you from the bottom of my heart. So we have a different philosophy in some ways. So is that always to say that because Ian's company is privately owned and he's interested in making money, that's not a bad thing?
No.
It's not a bad thing, but there is a difference, right, mm-hmm. in focus, and some of you have pointed that out, that if you want to work for us, you've got to have a social service mentality. You've got to have that. And some of us don't want that, right? So that's not a bad thing. There's nobody who is more interested in making money than me. But there is a different philosophy, isn't there? And part of what we talk about when I'm doing teaching here is what? We talk about researching and knowing what kind of job you want, right? So there it is, because they all said the same thing. We are looking for people who want to work for us and want to do the kind of work that we do, right? What's the number one thing that you could say to us in terms of a tip about the whole process of getting employed? Think for a moment. What's the number one thing? I mean, you've all talked about being on time. And I've had conversations with many of you because I've sent you students. And when I get a phone call back from one of these people saying, you know the student you sent me? They were 4.5 hours late for their interview, for their first day on the job. Or they fell asleep on the couch for 3 hours during a break. It's really upsetting to me. You know, it's sad for me, and I send a lot of students to some of your ways. On the other hand, Jodell, you've employed a lot of our students, right? And the Rising Stars, we've got one that you've promoted already.
Yeah, the last one of these, I hired someone on the spot.
On the spot.
She's now my, she's my assistant.
Yeah.
So she's incredible. Mm-hmm.
So what's one thing that you can really think of, besides being on time, dependability, huge, you've all said that, being on time, huge.
I would say, it's to be honest. So whether it's about your skills or what you're looking for or what your interests are or whether you are, faith-based or mission-based, or really be honest, because as a recruiter and, you know, when you go through the hiring process, that's going to be the person that you're talking to. Our job is to really get to know you and find the best spot. So if it's not, you know, this particular unit or this particular position, we are referring you to colleagues or giving you kind of that advice on where you should maybe look. So be honest. Don't tell us what you think we want to hear. Honestly, tell us, like, your true self.
Other tips, go ahead.
I would say one of the biggest things that I am looking for is someone who has the heart of someone who chose healthcare on purpose. My very first question I ask everybody in the interview is, how did you get started? What prompted you to go to school to be a fill in the blank, a medical assistant or a phlebotomist or whatever the position is that you're applying for? So I think that really answers that motivation question, really takes care of a lot of the other things. If you're choosing healthcare on purpose because you specifically have a heart for wanting to provide the best care for our patients, then we're not going to have to worry as much about whether you're going to come in late or make poor decisions that are going to put patient safety at risk or any of those different types of things, because you're choosing to come to work because you want to be in healthcare versus you just need to do the bare minimum to get a paycheck. So kind of have that be something that you're thinking about, and why am I doing this anyway? Why did I go to school on a healthcare path, and why am I looking for a job in healthcare, and be able to articulately explain that?
Ted, you got a tip, a big one?
I think enthusiasm carries a lot of weight with me. Also self-confidence, but I would also warn you folks, there's a real thin line between self-confidence and arrogance. If you cross that line, you're done. I'm sorry, I don't know how to tell you how to get there. But if you can come in and be enthusiastic about who you are, about the organization that you've studied, that's really, really good.
Okay.
And if you can be self-confident about who you are, what you've accomplished, without crossing that line of being an arrogant bragger, I think you'll do really, really well, at least in interviews with someone like me.
I love that. Got a tip? One biggie?
Yeah, I have to go back to Amanda. Is what Amanda said. Why are you applying for this role? Why are you in healthcare? That's big for us, really big with community health, especially is making sure you're in it for the right reasons. And like I said, it's not about getting a JOB or a paycheck. It's going out there to serve the community and getting a healthy community.
Anyone else?
One for me is flexibility. So in a home care, you have to be very flexible. We can get a new client. I have a text right now that we have a client starting at 4. And so we'll need someone to basically draw their clothes and be somewhere in 30 minutes so that you're willing to do whatever it takes for the client, for the company.
Yeah, great. One last question for me, and I'll let them talk to you. Criminal history. Now, we all know that we have to have certain things to get licensed, right? But at the same time, how are you treating those issues in each of your companies? Are you doing additional criminal history searches? How are you treating it? You just go down the road here.
So we do a background check, which is the BCCU unit, and that's a requirement to work on, you know, at our facility that's mandated by the state. And then if usually there, most often there's no background or there's no rap sheet, so we just move on. And then there's a fingerprint check. That's a requirement. There's some, if you worked at another adult family home, then maybe you don't have to get the fingerprint if it was done prior to this. There's a bunch of other whacks and rules in there. But for the most part, if somebody does have a background, you know, or have a rap sheet, and it's like non-disqualifying, then I'm open to hearing the case and finding, as long as the rules say, hey, it's non-disqualifying, then hey, let's hear your story. Everybody was 19 or 20, and maybe they're still that age at 30, but you know, they made a mistake. And so let's find out what the mistake was. Was it an honest, was it just a silliness, you know? And then we'll move on from there. And if you can't work at our facility, then maybe there's an associate that I know of that might, you know, but it's gonna be specifically healthcare. If any violence, you know, you're looking at, it's obvious stuff, sexual abuse, things like that.
Do you use the DSHS background?
Yeah, that's what we're mandated
okay.
to use.
And so then, how about CPS history?
You know, it's not.
So it's they not make more. The decision and send it to you?
Yeah.
So tell me how that works so they understand. You send in the DSHS background check sheet.
And yeah, and then what would
happen? And they'll send back to you what?
They'll send back results saying, hey, we did a, in the Washington State database, and I think they're doing cross-references now throughout other
yep.
states
yep.
too. They'll say there's no disqualifying and there's no rap sheet, right? But now if there, I have one candidate that they did have a rap sheet and it was domestic violence, and the story was that her and her boyfriend, abusive relationship, and she was the one that got arrested. So, well, what happened? So then we do a little research on that, and through the background unit, they said it's non-disqualifying. So that then my red flag goes down, and maybe an orange flag now. Let's go through, you know, I get a story, and we do basically a character assessment, a character review, and they're on 90-day probation, right? So if they sneeze wrong, I can't risk it. Liability, insurance, and the welfare of the residents that we're providing care for. So
great.
That person's out.
Great.
We have all of our job offers are contingent upon successful completion of a background check, and so we do that with our national onboarding team. And with that, it kind of is on a case-by-case basis. Most things come back clear, but then whenever there is an alert, it's something that it is not necessarily something that we just automatically rule out employment. We take a look at what came back, what were the results, what does that look like, and maybe have a conversation with you about it, get the backstory. It's not always as clear-cut as it looks on paper, so figure out what the circumstances were, how long ago was it, is it something that's relevant to the work environment or not. So one of our HR managers will reach out to anybody who comes back with an alert to kind of get all the information and do some research there and then make a determination from there. In my last 3 years of recruitment, I haven't had a single person get ruled out from employment because of a background check. And that doesn't mean there haven't been alerts from time to time, but nothing that's ever ruled someone out from employment. And I think we tend to be on the more conservative side of things for patient safety and all of that, of course. And so it's something we handle on a case-by-case basis.
Yeah.
When anybody comes in, after they get through the interview process, if we offer them a position, we sit down and do an hour's worth of paperwork. And one of these forms is a DSHS background check. So you folks would need to put in your social security number, your driver's license, all that stuff, and it goes, and we have to send that into DSHS. They used to send it to Washington State Patrol, which was fine. A couple of years ago, they started sending it, I believe, to the FBI. And now all of a sudden, and my staff has to redo this every 2 years. And instead of tracking who's at 1 year, I just make everybody do it every year. And before, 95% of them would come back with nothing. But after we went to this FBI database, all of a sudden, a third of my staff have like a DUI from 20 years ago, and now it's showing up in their records. But it's fine. I haven't let anybody go for anything like that. But again, there's something called the Secretary's List of Disqualifying Crimes or something like that. If your crime is on that list, you cannot work in my building. Because all of my staff touch assisted living residents who go under assisted living guidelines for DSHS. So that's basically how we operate. If somebody comes back with any type of a crime, so every year I have to talk to like a third of my staff about their DUI from 12 years ago. It's ridiculous, but it's what we have to do. And I have to document that I talked to them, and I was convinced that they don't pose any threat to my residents. It's fine. And I haven't had any new ones come up with the type of violent crimes we're talking about, whether it's assault or financial exploitation. Those are immediately disqualifying. They cannot be in your building. And even I had an employee that was accused of something, and I was told by DSHS I should have suspended her even before she was convicted. And I said, you gotta be kidding. That's not right. But DSHS said nope, because if she did anything wrong, it would have been your responsibility.
Great.
So yeah, they're pretty sticky about it. As far as DSHS is concerned, yes.
Yeah. We do fingerprints and background checks, and the main thing that I'm looking for is if something comes up, what is your story? I will sit down and talk with you about it, and if you're honest about it and never going to happen again type of story, we normally will still employ you. We're looking for if there's any theft, because you're one-on-one in someone's home, I really can't have you work for us. Any type of abuse, those are the two main things I'm looking for.
Yeah, Jesse.
Okay. I don't know a whole lot about this part because I'm not actually involved in the actual recruitment process, but we do go through Washington State Patrol. I know that we do pass over candidates. Heidi, you might know a little bit more.
Yeah, we do Washington State Patrol. We've never had anything that we didn't. It was a not hiring.
Do you get conviction data only?
Like DUIs, things like that.
But when you get the report, is it just conviction data or is it all arrests?
Just conviction.
So the distinction there is important for you all to know.
I've seen drug stuff, and we've definitely like dropped candidates over it.
Yep, sure.
So we actually use HireRight to run our background checks.
So you're paying
a
private company to run a background,
yes.
And you are getting reports this day.
We are sometimes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I want to just point that out to you. What they're doing, they're getting everything.
Mm-hmm.
Every time you sneezed wrong, you do that too. Same as Providence.
Yeah.
These folks are getting reports this thick. I got one. I'll show it to you sometime. Actually, it's a little embarrassing. It's got everything in it, doesn't it?
Yeah. It's really only felonies generally that will disqualify you, as well as any assaults or sexual assault, physical assault, anything like that.
Crime against person.
We also require drug screens, and even though marijuana is legal in the state of Washington because we receive federal grants, the federal government, obviously it's not legal with the federal government, so we actually prohibit use of that.
Yeah. Thank you for bringing that up. You guys do drug testing?
We test at, I think, right after you're hired, but we don't keep testing.
Don't do pre-employment testing.
We actually do test before you're hired.
You do pre-employment?
Oh.
Okay, yeah.
Oh, right, yeah.
Yep.
Pre-employment, but then they don't like do randoms or anything like that afterwards.
Okay.
We do pre-employment drug screens as well as reasonable suspicion, which I haven't encountered that yet, as well as for any injury, whether you're at fault or it's a not at fault, everybody will get drug tested.
So important here, just because marijuana is legal in Washington State, it is not legal on the federal level. Yes?
What about people who use it for health purposes?
Medicinal purposes. What do you do with that?
Federal government's
the They have a card.
Green cards don't count.
I don't have one, but I'm just asking.
Yeah.
I think we had a CBD patient that actually got through, but that's it.
Yeah. Let me open it up. I've talked long enough. Go ahead. Mm-hmm. What's your questions? Go ahead.
So I've actually gotten to my first one. So in some situations, I know the state will allow you to work in healthcare because something was dismissed, and so you go to the state. Would you still disqualify if that came up when y'all did a background check?
So give us a concrete example. What was it and what was dismissed?
A domestic violence situation.
Okay, so it was dismissed then?
Dismissed, everything's come back clear, been 9 years.
It shouldn't show in the report that it was dismissed. It shouldn't.
For him. Remember, what we've ascertained is it's going to show up for some other.
As long as it's not a conviction, it's been dismissed, then
Because it was dismissed, is just a charge, and it's saying that you weren't convicted, so you're innocent. That's my understanding of the law.
For us, we'd have a conversation with the individual. If that person could convince me that he or she was not necessarily the instigator, they'd be defending themselves, whatever the case may be, I'd try and get as much information. If I believe the person, I would then I have still hired somebody in those circumstances.
Another thing too that just came to mind is we do we rerun your certification. So if you are under investigation for something that happened at one facility and you try to apply with Providence, it will actually show us that something is pending on your license and we are not able to move you forward if that's the case.
What was your second question?
My second question is anybody, does anybody do strictly phlebotomy jobs?
So I know all the clinics. Yeah, so Amanda does, the other clinic, Kaiser does, CHC does. Do you have phlebotomy?
We actually bring LabCorp in.
Okay, so you don't hire directly, but you don't either anymore?
Really?
Mm-hmm. Really? No phlebotomists?
Not in the clinics. That
not the clinics, but in the hospital.
Yeah, there are some.
Yeah. Yeah?
I have a question about the clinic. I'm sorry, the hospital. I heard that Providence is actually moving to LabCorp, I think it's called, something like that.
But that's the reference lab that Providence works with. Mm-hmm. So the details of how that will work out are not in place yet.
So does that affect anybody applying for a phlebotomy position?
No.
Okay. Because I've seen that a lot of your positions actually say 6 months positions because of the switch. Is that correct?
Oh. Honestly, I'm not sure. I didn't know that. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay.
You're saying that it's close to the temporary position?
Yeah, like all your positions are actually listed as temporary for 6 months. I've heard it's due to the switch.
Is that phlebotomy position?
I haven't heard.
Yeah.
Oh.
Right. Are you seeing it on their career website or on something else?
On the website, and I've actually heard it from someone who's currently employed there as a phlebotomist.
Are you interested in that role?
Yeah.
If you'd like, you can give me information. I'm happy to look into that for you. I don't really answer right now.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Heather.
How about medical coding? Is that a position or an opportunity in any of your...
right now, I need a medical biller.
Medical coding?
We have billing.
Billing and coding? Mm-hmm. Yeah, same. Billing and coding.
Although... that staffing is done by another team, which is done more through a centralized service.
Okay.
So they hire billers or coders centrally, and then they are then filtered to different parts of the organization. So we on our team do not recruit for them, but if there are opportunities available, that would be done by another department.
But you do administrative reception and all the front desk, so all the clinics. Do you have administrative front desk people at your place, Ken?
Yes.
Okay. So the clerical functions, the administrative functions, medical records, HMIS, is that what it is?
HIS, yeah.
HIS. So I don't know, some of you are interested in front office, back office?
Yep.
So all the clinics do it, the hospital does it, Washington Oaks does it. Other questions?
Would those positions be posted online?
Those positions are all posted?
Yes.
Yeah. If they're open, then it would be online.
Mm-hmm. Part-time or full-time? Or they're all full-time?
It would depend on the individual position itself, but it would indicate in the job posting if it was a full-time, a part-time, or a temporary short-term position. It would say in the posting details.
Yeah, one thing too with Providence Careers Profile, I'm sorry, you can actually go create a profile and then set preferences to show the type of positions you're interested in, your availability, things like that, and it will actually alert you whenever a new position is posted with that criteria. So I'd recommend that you all do that if you're interested.
Any of those part-time positions that would be posted, would they be flexible with the school schedule as well?
I guess, yes. Yes. Yeah, so for the hospitals, so for a lot of the unit coordinators, the support roles, the technician positions, you are usually required to work 2 weekends a month, so they do usually rotate. Yes, they do try to be flexible, but you are required to be available for your shifts. So that can look different based on where you apply.
Thank you.
Yes.
Well, first off, I just wanted to take the opportunity to say thank you to all of you on behalf of us. I think the wealth of information that you shared was absolutely insightful. So my question is, how early is early enough for us to start applying? Like, whether it's a question of, given the fact that, for example, many of us are just getting started in our programs, would we be better off getting more education under our belt before applying, or kind of waiting closer to time for past graduation, or is as early as possible better?
Well, let me piggyback on that, because then it's kind of like the question too, should we get into healthcare early even if we're not doing our profession and working around healthcare as quickly as possible even if we're not where we want to end up? Kind of, is that what?
Yeah, I would say can kind of go either way. If you're looking to wait to get a job until you actually are graduated and finished your program, the main kind of line in the sand there is, do you have your certification for the Department of Health? That the day that goes active is the day that you're eligible to begin applying and being considered for those types of positions. That being said, if you have the availability to work while you're in school, medical receptionist positions and things like that are something that you can apply for anytime, because the only main requirement for that is being a high school graduate. Then you'd be eligible anytime to be able to work in those roles, and then ultimately, hopefully, promote into whatever your clinical type role is once you have that certification.
How about the rest? Anyone else have a reaction to that question?
Yeah, like for me, if you're looking to work as a CNA, we can hire you while you're going to school. One of the students that Angela sent us, she's in school now, and she applied for a NAR license, and so I don't know if Angela's talked much about that, but as long as you have a NAR license through the state, I can hire you. You just have to get your CNA license within 6 months. So it's a good thing that you could be working as a caregiver while going to school as a CNA.
And we have talked about that. NARS or nursing assistant registration. All you need is your first aid and your HIV. Actually, all you really need is your HIV AIDS. And you can apply for that license through the DOH, and we will pay for it if you're an ICAT student. And many of you do, and then you go to work with Jodell and work your way through the healthcare system as you're going to school. So
and we place you in like a real companionship in the beginning, and that way as you're progressing in your studies, then when you get the CNA license, you do more medically complex cases.
Mm-hmm. And that's the same with my situation too.
Right.
So
right.
You probably just wouldn't be eligible to work solo, so you'd always have another, maybe a CNA with you.
One more, go ahead.
Physical limitations. So for each one of you, what types of physical disabilities or limitations would not work with your facility?
really depends on the job. I could have somebody working at my front desk that couldn't walk. But again, you couldn't be a dining room server, you couldn't be a CNA, so it really depends on the type, particular type of work you want to do, but,
Like, do you have lift requirements for, like, say, a CNA, how much they need to be able to lift? What's that?
And all the...
I don't know what it is on the top of my head. But our, for example, our CNAs help folks with a shower. And if you're doing that, that could be fairly weighty.
I know for most job postings, you'll actually see that if there's lifting requirements or what some of the physical requirements would be for those positions. And then there's also reasonable accommodation, depending on the different accommodation that may need to be requested to allow you to be able to do the essential job function.
You all good? So what I would ask you to do for the next 20 minutes, one more, go ahead.
I just had something pop into
go ahead.
Into mind. Do any of you do market interviews to help us work on those skills when we are ready to apply?
I would be happy to. So take my card for you, Leah.
We're going to do a mock interview class next quarter, and I'm going to be bringing some of these folks in to help me. So. They don't know that yet. The invitations have not been extended yet, but yes, thank you. So what I would ask you to do is come out from behind that table. Let's take about 15, 20 minutes and let people come and meet you. And thank you so much.